Quest presents an unabridged recording of Stella's Story by Louise Allen with Teresa McAvoy, narrated by Melanie Crawley. Part 1. 1. October.
It's happening right now. Please come.
Shannon hits send on her mobile phone just in time before the next wave of pain engulfs her whole body. She screws up her eyes so that they are shut tight, not knowing quite why that helps. When the pain recedes, almost as quickly as it came, and she is able to open her eyes again, she is dazzled by the brightness of the room once more. Above her, clinical white walls dissect white tiles at sharp right angles, illuminated by a fluorescent strip bulb. She feels suffocated by the bleaching whiteness. It is all so hopelessly unforgiving inside here. The windows gape black against all the white and light of the room. It seems to have got so dark outside so fast. Or has she been here much longer than she thinks? Shannon is vaguely aware of some music playing in the background. The track sounds familiar, though she can't quite register the song itself, or even make out any lyrics. The playlist that she made for giving birth doesn't really seem to be helping. She had planned for the final track to be Underworld's Born Slippy, old now, but classic, though it feels as though that moment is a long, long way off yet. She needs more than music to help her now. Isn't there meant to be some sort of pain relief?
Where is he? She thinks. I need him here. I hate him. Where the hell is he? Terry? Terry, don't do this. Where are you?
Shannon oscillates between wanting Terry right there with her by her side and despising him for getting her into this state. How is it fair that he can just up and go, leaving her to do this bit all by herself? One minute, she wishes he was there holding her hand, massaging her aching back, stroking her forehead. The next, she knows she wants to do this all on her own. It is her moment. Even the midwife had seemed surprised when Shannon arrived at the hospital alone.
No one at all? Not a partner? Your mum? A friend? There must be someone I can call for you, love.
Shannon had thought about calling the girls, Vivi and Tara. They had joked about being birth partners for her when she was much earlier in the pregnancy. But Shannon doesn't really think that they would be a great deal of help, and she doesn't want to give any satisfaction to this midwife, who is a condescending bitch anyway. Who is she to call Shannon love? Shannon can still hear the judgment ringing in the midwife's voice when she was admitted to the labour ward an hour or so earlier.
You're just a child yourself. Are you sure I can't get your mum here?
Not just judgmental, but downright unsupportive.
It's not usual to do this on your own, you know. What was usual, anyway?
And a midwife shouldn't be passing comment on her choices, anyway. She can do what she likes. This woman is exactly the opposite of what a midwife is supposed to be, Shannon is sure. She remembers reading that the healthcare professionals are supposed to respect your decisions. Right now, she doesn't feel as though any of her decisions have been respected, inside the hospital or out of it. But with each contraction bringing her closer to the most important thing she has ever done, Shannon hurts so badly. And the stupid midwife is right. She doesn't really want to be all on her own. She shouldn't be all alone. He promised. He promised. But he has broken promises before. And things are tricky for Terry right now, she reminds herself. He's trying to lie low after a little deal that went wrong last week. It wasn't his fault. Shannon knows that he can't risk being where the police might be able to find him easily. But she still can't entirely shake away the nagging doubts that the baby has been keeping him away too. She has tried to stay fun all the way through the pregnancy, but hormones have made her tired and grumpy at times, however much she has tried to ignore them. And it's difficult to feel attractive when you are lugging around a belly as large as this one. It's bigger than a ripe watermelon. Though Shannon has worked hard to keep herself looking good, not like some who let themselves go once they start to show. She has positively glowed inside each time someone has told her what a neat bump she has, friends and strangers alike. Perhaps she should have told her mother about the baby after all, even after everything that happened between them. It's not like Shannon hasn't thought about it over the last few months. But how hard had her parents tried to find her when she left? Really? Shannon didn't even get a birthday card last week. But then, be fair, she thinks. She hasn't told her mother where she is living these days. Her mother wouldn't approve of the flat, nor the neighbourhood, and definitely not Terry. The birthday was her 17th, and now she is experiencing another birthday. But this one doesn't feel anything like a celebration. Shannon actually feels like giving up now. That's it, she decides. She isn't going to do it. She wants out. She wants out of this whole deal. Pregnancy, baby, the lot. She's too young for any of this. It wasn't meant to be. She wants it all to stop. She didn't sign up for this. Not the pain. Not the being alone. Not the bloody baby. None of it. She wants out. But the baby inside her doesn't, yet. Terry, the sod, is still not replying to her message. Fathers are supposed to be there at the birth of their children these days, aren't they? Assuming, of course, that Terry is the father. But in practical terms, Terry is the best bet she has, currently. Where are you? Her fingers press send again while her brain tells her that the messages are making her sound desperate. Right now, though, Shannon is desperate, though it probably isn't the best plan to let Terry know how desperate. He can be quite manipulative when he wants to be. She tells herself that millions of women have done this before her, given birth. She is not the first teenager to do this. She is young and fit and tough. She braces for the next contraction. Now, the midwife is by her side and stroking her back and telling her how well she is doing, how brave she is being, as Shannon screams out, colouring the white walls blue with creative obscenities. That's some choice language you've got there, love. The carefully cultivated Cockney drawl that has characterised Shannon's speech over the last year or so is gone momentarily. And the clipped home counties vowels that she has so carefully hidden for so long break through. She is sobbing now.
I can't do this. I really can't do this. Oh, God, please. You have to help me.
Shannon grips the midwife's arm as though holding on to a straw. You can, and you will. You've come this far, love. You're doing a grand job. Keep going. I can see the head. You're nearly there, Shannon. One big push for me now. Go on, girl. Shannon turns her head away from the accusatory white walls and bright lights and focuses instead on the stars appearing in the darkening skies, framed by the tiny window of the hospital room. With every single ounce of strength left within her, she concentrates on doing this momentous thing. A child pushes another child out into the world. It happens quickly in the end. Terry, of course, is not there to witness the birth of the daughter that might be his.
It's a girl!
In the piece after the delivery, Shannon experiences an unexpected rush of love for the little pink thing that lies across her, its eyes closed, a faintly furrowed expression forming across the forehead. A baby. A whole miniature human being. A brand new little life. Shannon is awed by the whole miracle and marvel of it. But it isn't long before a strange feeling of anticlimax overtakes her. Where are the popping champagne corks and the friends and father to share the miracle moment with? Later in the evening, a couple of her flatmates do arrive. A little tipsy,
from wetting the baby's head before they got to the hospital. Shannon is touched that Tara and Vivi have clubbed together for the baby's first gift, a cute little poppered cotton baby grow set, more white to go with the whiteness of the room. Cheap and cheerful, really, but you can't really go wrong in Asda, can you? Chuckles Tara. And she won't have a clue it's not designer, not at her age. God, Shannon, she's so beautiful. Look at you now, a real mum. Vivi is reverent in the wake of her friend's new status. I know it seems as though you've been pregnant like forever, but it's real now. She's really here, an actual baby. Can I hold her? All three girls are awkward as they handle the baby between them. It is the proverbial blind leading the blind. No, not like that. You've got to make sure you support the neck, preaches Shannon, echoing what she has been told by the midwife. The baby is oblivious to the clumsy passing around. It sleeps a lot, Tara observes when it is her turn to hold, not quite knowing what else to say. And so small. Look at them tiny fingers, says Vivi, rubbing them between her own. It's like a doll. She's like a doll, Shannon corrects her. She's not an it. She's quite pink, though, isn't she? Is she meant to be that pink? It means she's healthy, says Shannon quickly. She doesn't mention that she has wondered the same thing herself, but not wanted to mention it to the midwife. Course she is. Look at her. Beautiful, isn't she? Tara reassures her. Steady on. You'll be having one next if you start talking like that. I wouldn't. It bloody hurts a lot, Shannon says with all her newfound authority of a few hours in the world of motherhood. What was it like? Is it as bad as they say? Did they give you drugs? Did they have to stitch you up after? Shannon regales her wide-eyed friends with detailed descriptions of the birth. She focuses on the physical and leaves out the emotional strain she feels. But Vivi must catch something of her melancholy. I'll be there, like, whenever you need me, she coos. Is that me, or the baby? You, Shan, you daft thing. But yeah, the baby as well. Both, of course. Vivi smiles at her friend. We can be like aunties, Tara suggests, not to be left out of the loving. Get you off to the best start in life. Keep you away from the lowlifes. Treat you proper. Only the best for this little one. The grand statements of commitment come thick and fast, and they truly believe them as they are being made. But the glow they leave begins to disappear almost as soon as the door closes behind Tara and Vivi, and Shannon and her baby are left alone. Time keeps on ticking by. They are in a private room. The midwife offered, and it seemed like a good idea to take it. But now, Shannon wishes that she was on a ward with other new mums for company. Shannon is faintly surprised to discover that she is bored by this tiny creature who just doesn't seem to do very much at all. She notices that she feels claustrophobic, quietly trapped by the walls, the whiteness, the smothering needs of mothering. She has an urge, which she can't quite explain and would never admit to having, to open up the little window and throw the baby out of it. That would sort things out. She has no idea where the thought has come from. Hormones. It goes as quickly as it came, but she is unable to forget that she had the thought, and there is no one around to reassure her about the vulnerability that a new mother feels. The first day is so, so long. Shannon is exhausted and wide awake. It feels a little bit like jet lag. There is nothing to do in this maternity room. The telly only has terrestrial channels. You can pay for more, but Shannon hasn't got any money. She is in pain, but it is nothing like the pain of actual childbirth. She finds herself longing for the baby to wake up for a feed. At least it would be something to do,
The whole palaver of it all takes up time, and there is a sort of novelty to it, so far, anyway. Terry doesn't make it to the hospital until nearly 24 hours later. Shannon is buoyed up again when he eventually gets there. He arrives without warning, not even a little cryptic text, just as evening falls the next day. A small teddy bear, wrapped in cellophane and tied with a bow, nestles in the bottom of the carrier bag he throws towards her.
"Congratulations, babes," he shouts. "Catch?"
The relief at seeing him eliminates the barrage of recriminations Shannon had planned, but her face falls when he tells her that he is back on the run straight after tonight.
"It's not safe, darling. You wouldn't want to see me hurt now, would you?"
She tries to put the reality of what that might mean out of her mind. The new baby, oblivious to her fate being played out around her in the white hospital room, sleeps on through Terry's entrance.
"She looks like me. Do you think she looks like me?" "She does,"
he says, staring through the glass sides of her cot.
"She's got my nose, I reckon. See? Look."
He points, but makes no move to pick up his baby. Instead, he winks lewdly at Shannon and leans forward to dispense a kiss.
"Clever girl. You made another human being. Thirsty work.
Cause for celebration, I reckon." He flaps open his denim jacket so that the inside pocket and its contents are visible to the new mother. She grins at him.
"You know me well, babe."
They leave the baby sleeping. Shannon peeps back through the glass panel in the door.
"She sleeps for hours, it's all she does do. She won't wake yet,"
Shannon advises. Together, they head outside the hospital via a fire exit that Terry spotted on the way in.
"I'm not sure we should..."
"Who are you telling what to do? Christ, you're not going to turn into one of them nagging slags, are you, Shan? Save it for the kid. Tell it what to do. Not me."
"She," thinks Shannon. "She's not a bloody object. But she knows better than to say it out loud."
Terry cracks open the tin of Stella Artois that he has bought for them to share as a loving cup. Shannon loves this rebellious side of him. And really, who is going to care that they are outside a fire exit? She giggles as she takes a too large slurp from the little opening, and liquid trickles down the side of her mouth onto her chin.
"I'm out of practice,"
Shannon laughs.
"You're dribbling. Thought it was babies that were meant to do that."
Terry licks lager off her face while reaching into his other pocket for his baccy tin. The spliff is ready rolled. It takes him a couple of goes to light the end. They look up above them to see the windows of Shannon's ward, and Terry, inhaling deeply, gestures a toast, as though he is the guest of honour at a fine banquet, instead of skulking out in the cold by a dirty fire exit outside the maternity wing of the hospital while on the run from the police.
"To our little girl."
"Our little girl,"
Shannon chimes back, resting her head on Terry's shoulder. Terry reaches to take the tin can back, swapping it for the spliff. Shannon savours the smoke curling into her mouth before drawing it down to her lungs, relishing the longed-for hit. She had really tried to cut back on the smoking and the drugs and the drinking until the last few months when she figured that the baby was grown enough to not get damaged.
"I never want to forget this moment,"
she whispers. They pause, steadying themselves against one another beneath the stars. It is a clear night. The lager can is illuminated against the night sky, its circular red blazon bold against the white. Struck by sudden inspiration from the logo, he says solemnly,
"It won't. Let's call her Stella."
Shannon laughs again at the deliciously subversive element of the idea. It's so perfect.
"Stella is a beautiful name,"
she agrees, trying it out on the night air.
"Stella."
She remembers, distantly, from Latin lessons at her expensive independent school that it means star.
To Stella, she smiles, draining the last dregs of the tin.
Two. It is late morning and the bus is empty, save for a whiskered man taking up two seats at the back and a voluminous sari-clad woman at the front. Shannon opts for somewhere in the middle, as far away from her fellow passengers as she can. She stumbles while fumbling for the right change in her purse, not quite trusting the newborn sling that the hospital have lent her. She stays standing. There is no sign or word from Terry. He isn't answering his mobile or responding to any of her texts. She hadn't thought to bring the pram to the hospital when the labour began, and she can't think of anyone else to ask for help. She just sort of assumed that she would be driven back from the hospital. There is a picture in her head of loving parents strapping their precious cargo into a car seat. But Terry doesn't even have a car at the moment, so that was always going to be a fantasy. And right now, she hasn't got the slightest idea where he is or what he is up to. He was totally vague on detail when he left the hospital last night, and she was exhausted and a little bit stoned. She does at least have keys to the flat, so she can let herself in, even if he isn't there. So now, here she is, on the drafty number 47, a new young mother making her way home for the first time, pretending that she knows something about what she is doing. This very ordinary thing, taking a bus ride, seems to have assumed mythic proportions. It is Stella's first journey out into the actual world. At least the rhythmic swaying and reassuring engine hum seem to be soothing the baby. Shannon, by contrast, feels far from soothed. Already her nipples are sore. Breastfeeding didn't really happen in any sort of sustained way. The idea slightly repulses her anyway. She associates it with animals. So the hospital has given her a supply of formula, with a bottle mixed for the way home, just in case. Shannon doesn't know how long it will be until Stella wakes up, but her neck is also hurting from the strange position she has been contorted into. They've done this sling up so tight, too tight. But Shannon isn't sure how to adjust it, and it's safer not to try. It would be a disaster if she unravelled on the bus. She looks down at the little pink face nestled in the sling, which wrinkles into a frown as she tries to sit down. Sari woman turns round and gives Shannon a smile. Shannon tries to smile back, but it turns into a grimace as the bus handles a corner and Shannon has to hang on tight to stop Stella's little head from hitting the railing. When she casts a glance behind, the whiskery bloke ignores her, actually looking pointedly in the other direction. Shannon knows that she would have got a lechy look at the very least from someone like him just a few months before. Now she is of no interest, desexualised by the baby. She's not sure whether to be relieved or upset. As the bus pulls back out into the road, Shannon wonders just how the hell she is going to do all of this. It doesn't seem fair to be by herself for the birth and now for this first journey. Well, that's clearly how it's going to be, so I'm just going to have to get on with it, she thinks. From nowhere, a vision of her own mother pops into her head. Shannon tries to push the image away, but just like in real life, she is stubborn. No, you're not getting your hands on Stella, she resolves. No way. But just for a moment, it would be so nice to know that there was someone there that she could turn to. The neatly bobbed hair, immaculately tied scarf and cashmere sweater combo that form the unmistakable image of Jill, Shannon's adopted mother, refuses to disappear. But what would Jill know anyway? They weren't capable of having their own children, so Jill has never had to do this whole baby thing herself. Shannon experiences a tiny satisfaction in having been able to do something that Jill couldn't. Jill and Simon had tried for nearly 10 years to have a baby before adopting two boys, and then Shannon. Shannon went to them when she was 4 years old and doesn't remember much about life before that. What she does remember is the stifling neatness of everything, born of Simon's naval background and Jill's obsession with hygiene, and the enthusiasm that bordered on fetish with anything old, antique and historical. The house they lived in was 4 centuries old and flaunted its sprawling oak-beamed loveliness. Jill was desperate to scream about how cultured they all were and had the rhyme of the ancient mariner framed in the entrance hall. They made sure that everyone knew they had a second home in Gibraltar by having the architectural drawings on display in a cabinet by the telephone table. It was an artificially constructed family of high achievers. Failure was not an option. Simon had medals for heroic military actions, had even conducted some dangerous rescue in peacetime that hit the headlines. The newspaper cutting from the Telegraph was mounted and framed in the study. Shannon's adopted brothers had both sailed through their respective red brick universities with sporting blues. There were trophies proclaiming their glory and triumph and bloody superiority on every shelf of the immaculately preserved 17th century country house. Shannon isn't sure at precisely what age, or why, she made the conscious decision to reject the privilege and opportunity that a private education afforded her. Perhaps it was a result of being packed off to a boarding school so young. Much was made of the ability to pay for a private education in order to support the transient nature of Simon's naval life. Shannon was sent miles away from the family home in order to be sorted out. And she was sorted out. For a long time. Swimming was her thing. It gave her the routine and the discipline that she needed. And of course, Jill and Simon lapped that up. They could not have been more supportive when Shannon showed some talent, first representing the school where the PE staff told her adoptive parents that she had natural ability, and then being approached by a coach for a local team. But swimming is all-consuming. By 15, the training meant 5 early mornings a week. It meant no highlights in her hair. She tried once. They went green. It meant no acrylic nails. What was the point? They just lifted off after a few days. And weekends were lost to competition. Once she was swimming at county level, they traipsed all over the country every Saturday and Sunday. There was talk of an England trial. In good time for Olympic selection. And then one day it all changed. The drive was gone. She still doesn't really know what triggered it. Shannon's alarm had gone off while it was still dark one morning. In the blackness, she decided that she just couldn't face the thought of the cold morning, clambering into the nylon swimsuit, the chlorine in her throat, her coach talking 19 to the dozen about ambition and commitment. She realised that it wasn't her ambition. She pulled the duvet up higher and just thought, fuck it. And that was the end of the swimming. She wasn't allowed to give it up without a fight, and that's when the rows with Jill and Simon, but especially Jill, who was a sanctimonious bitch at the best of times, had really begun. The number 47 bus lurches to a stop right outside the police station, but the pause in the journey doesn't interrupt Shannon's train of thought. Not really. Sari and Whiskers both stay on the bus, and a young lad, full of acne, bless him, gets on. Christ, it was only a few months ago, really, that she was worrying about tiny things like the condition of her skin. How different Shannon's life has become in such a short space of time. Not much more than a year, all told. She had spent a good few months waking up and thinking, fuck it, actually. It was easy to find friends outside of swimming club who actually had a vague idea about life. Shannon had occasionally been pissed at parties before,
whenever there had been a pause in the training schedule that allowed for a break, but the drinking began in earnest when she met Vivi and Tara at a club. Real people, not like the idiots at the private school. That's probably when she had dropped the posh girl accent too. Shannon wanted no part of it, and it was them, Tara and Vivi, who had first introduced her to Terry. Looking back, it was fair to say that that's where things had probably turned. Late nights, trying out different drugs, legal and illegal highs, overdoing it, going on the pill, sleeping around with Terry and some of the other men in his circle, not coming home some nights. Then all the friction with her folks, actually with Simon more than Jill towards the end. Shannon feels a momentary pang about what she has done to Simon, because, of course, they had both tried to reason with her at first, together and separately. Shannon's relationship with her adopted father was much stronger. He was always more fun than Jill. Perhaps that was a result of being able to swan about the world on big ships and have a life, while Jill was stuck at home keeping house. They had both tried to reset the boundaries once they had got over the swimming thing, but always at the back of Shannon's mind was the thought that they couldn't really tell her what to do, because they weren't her real parents. Her birth mother was out there somewhere. Jill wasn't her mother. Simon wasn't her father. What right did they have to dictate the direction of her life in any case? She wasn't their flesh and blood. She wasn't part of this ridiculous network and competitive hierarchy in private education and their circles. She didn't belong to it anyway. It wasn't her birthright. She was a fraud, an outsider. Simon became deeply frustrated and angry with her, and when the platitudes wouldn't work, there were ugly scenes. Shannon shudders as she recalls how, after a huge row, he pulled the plug of her stereo out of the wall because she couldn't hear him calling to her to turn it down. He was always actions, not words. Jill was the words. Always the bloody words. Wasn't she grateful for the start she had been given? Wasn't it time that she gave something back to her poor parents who had rescued her from a life of God knows what kind of hell and misery? Didn't she understand how lucky she was? What privilege and opportunities she had been given? Did she want to drag herself back down into the gutter where she came from? Well, she would bloody well show them that she could do life on her own way, her own rules. So, pregnant at 16, a mother at 17, she's certainly doing that. Oh yes, she is really showing Jill and Simon. She smiles, ruefully. The engine of the bus throbs back into life with the driver's gear change, the shift in rhythm conducting Shannon's thoughts back to that final, fateful day. It has crystallised in her memory. Every sour second. Shannon remembers that she had woken up feeling utterly nauseous. A sick sensation like never before, stabbing pains in her head, and the contents of her stomach seeming to want to evacuate themselves with an urgency that she couldn't remember ever feeling before. It must have been quite some session the night before. Images like snapshots floated into her mind as she crossed the hallway to the bathroom. She didn't quite make it. The walls, adorned with the many testaments to her family's greatness, the gilt-edged certificates, mounted grade 8 music diplomas, obligatory mortarboard posed photos clutching scroll, now had the addition of bile spatter, with the sweet stench of regurgitated cider to add to the mix. There wasn't much substance to it. It would probably wash off fine. Had she even eaten anything the night before? Shannon couldn't remember food being amongst the smorgasbord of drink and drugs that was on offer. She couldn't have even had a kebab on the way back, as there were no telltale lumps of undigested onion or white cabbage in the vomit. Christ, she must have been steaming. She remembers looking down at herself, wearing only pants and last night's crop top, her usually flat stomach, bloated, she supposed, from all the drinking. She had managed to get herself half undressed then, which meant she couldn't have been in that much of a state. And at least I managed to get my shoes off, she congratulated herself. But her head didn't, or wouldn't, stop banging, no matter how many pills she threw down her neck. Is that you, Shan? Shit. Why hadn't Jill gone out for her run, or yoga class, or whatever the hell other freaking health thing she did in the mornings? Shannon focused on the grandfather clock in the hallway next to her mother's bedroom. It took a few seconds for her eyes to settle and translate the Roman numerals into actual time. She'd slept until the afternoon. No wonder Jill was back. Shit. Shit.
Yeah, all good.
Shannon had managed to respond, the words feeling like cotton wool filling her face. But it wasn't all good. At all. She knew that something was very, very wrong. Young, fit girls didn't suffer hangovers like this, even after a night like that. Not without something being seriously wrong. What was wrong with her? Simon had given her a bucket to clean the hallway, like the decorated officer he was, handing out duties to one of his recruits. He watched her while she tried to scrub the horror away. And she had gagged again and thrown up into the toilet bowl this time. And then she had known. She had been on the pill, but it was easy to lose track of the days when you had big nights out and slept till lunchtime or beyond. She must have missed one, or more. She wonders now if Simon had suspected too. He knew what having a drink was all about. Cigars and port and large gins were a regular feature of his lifestyle. He might well have known that this was more than a hangover. It was Tara who jokingly suggested a pregnancy test. Shannon left home that day with a positive line on the plastic wand in her pocket, unable to reveal her condition to judgmental parents, and with only one destination available, Terry's notorious drug den. The bus stops again. They arrive on the shabbier, less salubrious side of town now, closer to home, past the tattoo parlours and fried chicken shops. Shannon eyes the graffitied bus shelter with its smashed pane of glass and wonders exactly what kind of world she is bringing her child into. This time, Whiskers breathes beery breath across Stella's exposed forehead as he stumbles a little while moving forward to the front of the bus to get off. Shannon moves her shoulder instinctively to protect the little bundle. She stops herself from thinking of joy, because joy is very far removed from what she's experiencing.
Don't worry, love, might never happen, Whiskers calls, looking back over his shoulder.
It already has, Shannon thinks. It already has. Anxiety overwhelms her suddenly. She is really not sure if she can do this alone. She can't even balance enough to reach up to ring the bell to let the driver know that her stop is next. Perhaps she has left it too late. Sari gives her another sweet smile. Shannon doesn't even bother to try and return it this time. It is going to take more than smiles to get her through. The bus pulls up outside the off-license by the estate. Her stop. She only hesitates for a moment before patting the last of the money in her pocket and ducking inside the glass door instead of going straight home. 3. The flat is empty, and it is a mess, a real state. Of course it is. Shannon doesn't know why she is surprised by that. There has been no magic marigold glove-wearing fairy to clean up while Shannon has been in hospital with Stella. What did she expect, frankly?
The only visitor appears to have been Terry, judging by the overflowing ashtray and trail of tobacco across the stained and patchy carpet. Shannon inhales stale air and wrinkles her nose in disgust, a disgust that she doesn't remember feeling before. She throws open a window, but then remembers that babies need to be kept warm, warmer than adults, she knows that much, and closes it again, noting how dirty the windows are. She wipes a finger across the grime that appears to coat the inside of the glass as well as its exterior. How do you even clean the outside this high up? She considers the problem for a moment. It has never occurred to her before. She looks across the room. There is a film of gunk on the coffee table, layers of sticky spilt drink and God knows what else. It doesn't seem quite right, somehow, to have a baby here, in this chaotic environment, after the whiteness and sterility of the labour ward. Shannon resolves to clean the place up. She will start in here and have a really good go at getting it sorted. There are probably cleaning products somewhere. And if not, she can go back out and get some from the corner shop. She's good for credit in there, because the owner uses and so can always knock it off what he owes Terry. After she's had a drink to fortify her spirits. The tinny flick of the ring pull wakes Stella, who begins to cry. Shannon curses under her breath and takes a giant swig before easing her little pink daughter from the sling. I'm still sore, she explains to the baby, from where you came out of me. She points to the can. It's got to be a better medicine than taking pills, so don't judge me. With those little beady baby eyes. Shannon is conscious that she feels a strange sense of exposure in front of her daughter, even though she is a tiny baby who knows nothing whatsoever of life yet. With Stella tucked into her arms, Shannon goes into the kitchen and starts opening doors randomly. She isn't quite sure what she is looking for, so there is no real purpose to her movements. There is no food in the house, apart from some stale cereal in the cupboard and some cuppa soup sachets. In the fridge are silver foil cartons of leftover vindaloo. The smell is pungent, and she shuts the refrigerator door fast. There is no point in looking in the freezer compartment. That hasn't worked for ages. She is definitely going to need to go shopping. Shannon notices that the cupboard door doesn't quite shut properly as she returns it, but hangs open drunkenly. She is finally looking at the world with the eyes of a new mother and noticing the hazards everywhere. But she reminds herself, logically, that it will be a few months before Stella is crawling and might get inside. There is plenty of time to sort this stuff out. She eyes the pile of washing up that is overflowing in the sink. Some of it has been there for weeks. That will have to stop, it really will. She takes a plate from the work surface and puts her foot out to open the kitchen bin, which is overflowing. Terry never empties it, never even seems to notice when it has got full. She remembers now being bothered by that in the beginning, back when she had first started staying in the flat. Stella is still crying, so Shannon doesn't try to empty the bin straight away, but balances the plate back on top of another teetering tower of unscraped plates and pots and cutlery. She is not sure where the bin liners are kept, anyway. There are no nappies in the house, other than the handful she has come away from the hospital with. Shannon wonders, idly, why she didn't get more ready before she went into labour. There is the pram, standing proudly in the hallway. It cost a fucking arm and a leg, as Terry had so poetically put it, but no cot for Stella yet. Shannon is not entirely sure that she believes in the yet. That implies it will happen in the future. Terry had said he was on it in the rare moments when she had pressed him. She didn't like to remind him because it smacked too much of commitment and domesticity, things she knew that he tried to avoid. But the fact is that Stella will have to sleep somewhere. The drawers in the bedroom are roughly cot-sized. One of those will have to do for the time being. The mattress from the pram will fit in it. She remembers studying improvisation in GCSE drama lessons. Well, this is real improvisation in the real world. The cries have reached an astonishing intensity now. Did Stella cry that loudly in the hospital? Maybe it just didn't sound like it because of the other babies on the maternity wing also making a noise. What does she want? Milk, perhaps. She must need a feed already. How long was that bus ride? Shannon reaches over a grimy work surface to flick the kettle on, noticing the flabby rolls where her stomach was pressing into the formica edge. How is it that she still looks, and feels, 4 or 5 months pregnant with the baby outside of her body? It doesn't seem fair. Terry isn't going to fancy her looking like this, wherever the bloody hell he is. Pride in what her body has done in giving birth is tainted with disgust at having had to do it at all. How has she ended up here? She tries to soothe Stella.
Yes, I want to cry too, little one. I'm not going to. I'm going to be bigger than that. It's no good two of us screaming the place down, is it?
As she rocks the baby and paces up and down the few feet of uncluttered space in the flat, she remembers her first meeting with Terry. The electric charge she had felt in the knowledge that she was playing in the big league, as far as men were concerned. Here was no schoolboy playing around with a packet of 10 after his homework was done. Here was a stubbly, sandy-haired, muscular, tattooed man. The image of a weasel pops into her head, but she dismisses it. He didn't have the expensive education that she'd had, but he was worldly wise, and that was part of his attraction. It was all Shannon could do to shield her own learning from him. She began to work harder on an affected Cockney accent to mask the telling home counties one that she so despised. Meanwhile, Terry seemed to like the kudos that his posh bird brought and enjoyed the often repeated joke that she was from the other side of the tracks. Her youth was another bonus that made him feel younger than his own drug-addled body did in the run-up to his 30th birthday. Stella continues to cry, but each time Shannon takes a sip from the can, she seems to mind a little bit less about the noise. It works like a tiny inoculation. Days pass this way. Every one of them feels longer than the last, and Shannon, alone, continually finds fresh new evidence of precisely how ill-equipped she is for motherhood. Stella, for all her sleeping, manages to be incredibly demanding. She gets a rash around the mouth that Shannon doesn't like.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.